Hallelujah, somebody. Hallelujah, somebody. Oh, what a blessing it is to be in the house of the Lord once and again. Through the sunshine, through the rain, through the sickness, and even through our pains. Our God has brought us from a mighty long way, and we should be glad to be in the house of the Lord one more time. Can we give the Lord a hand clap of praise and give him thanks this morning? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let us remain standing this morning for our call to worship, for our doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feet shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem.
Within thy courts is better than a thousand. I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wickedness.
Because of the house of the Lord, our God, I will seek thy good.
Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God.
Blessed are they that dwell in thy house. O Lord, I have loved thy habitation, the place where thy honor dwelleth.
For the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
O sing unto the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. All the earth sing praises.
And my beloved, we're going to forego our opening hymn on this morning, so you may be seated as our incredible praise ensemble comes before us on this morning.
God for grace today. Wondrous grace. Spectacular grace. Extraordinary. Incredible grace. It helped me. It touched me. It fixed me. It blessed me. It changed me. A witness. Thank you for grace.
Wondrous grace.
It'll heal you. It will fix you. It will build you up. It will strengthen you. It will deliver you. It will take you over. Thank you for grace. You don't deserve it. You couldn't pay for it.
Where would
would I be? Where would I be? I thank God for grace. Grace that brought me through my trials and my tribulations. Grace that healed me and fixed my broken heart. Thank him for
grace.
Grace that picked me up and turned me around and placed my feet on solid ground. I'm talking about
grace.
You know you don't deserve the blessings that you got right now. Couldn't work for it, couldn't pay for it, but God just reached out and gave you
grace.
He poured grace into your broken heart, your wounded life, your dysfunctional past. They said you'll never be nothing, but look at God.
Grace.
He picked you up and he said, I love you. I want you. I'll make something out of you. I'll turn you around, fix you up, and
grace.
Plant you where I want you to be. He's a mighty God. He's invincible. He's eternal. He's everlasting.
Grace.
You ought to tell somebody.
Grace.
Oh, thank you, Lord.
Where would I be?
Think about it. Think about it today. Think about it. I've got friends in jail.
Grace.
People in trouble. People in chaos and confusion.
Unjust grace.
It could have been, it should have been, would have been me. Yeah. But God,
grace.
When the devil thought he had me in his clutches and
unjust
he was coming
grace.
In for the kill, God stepped in a miracle of mercies and gave
grace.
Me. The witches tried to hex me. The devil
unjust
tried to
grace.
Curse me. My past tried to steal everything God wanted to do in my life.
Grace.
When justice demanded that I give up and die, mercy
unjust
stepped in
grace.
And said, I'll give you another chance. Thank him for it.
Grace.
Thank him for the grace that fixed you up, that brought
unjust
you out.
Grace.
The grace to give you a second chance. Can I get a witness?
Grace.
Can I get a witness in here? Somebody's living in it. Somebody's driving in grace. Somebody's wearing grace. Dressed up in God's grace. Walking in God's grace. Stepping in God's grace. Moving in God's grace. The devil thought he had you. That devil lied. God stepped in and fixed your broken heart. He gave you. Oh, thank you for grace. Thank you for grace. Every
grace.
Night, every night, every morning.
If it wasn't for your grace, where would I be?
Where would I be?
If it wasn't for your grace, where would I be? If it wasn't
you
for your
tell
grace,
somebody.
Where would I be? If it wasn't for your grace, where would I be? If it wasn't for your grace, where would I be?
What you say?
If it wasn't for your grace, where would
I
be?
Can I get a witness, sir?
If it wasn't for your grace, where would I be?
If it wasn't, if it wasn't.
If it wasn't for your grace, where would I be? If it wasn't for your grace, where would I be?
Somebody
if it wasn't for your grace, where would I be?
Look at you. Look at what God brought you through. Look, 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 look. Look, 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 look at God's amazing grace.
Where would I
oh, yeah. Thank him for the grace.
How many of you know that if it wasn't for his grace, if it wasn't for his grace, we do not know where any of us would ever be. Hallelujah, somebody. But his grace is sufficient for all of us. That is what makes it so amazing. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Blind, but now I see. God's grace. It's truly amazing. Hallelujah. Let us stand all around this church as we reaffirm our faith. Bethel, what do we believe?
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Church universal, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated in the Lord's presence.
Amen. By his grace. And by his grace, we can go before him with our prayer requests and petitions. So at this time, let us go before the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for this day. Father God, we thank you for the rain on yesterday. We thank you for the cleansing of the rain, oh God. We just want to say thank you. Father God, as we gather in your house on today, Lord God, let you look upon your people, Lord God, that are listening, Lord God, that are in your sanctuary, Lord God. You see the needs of your people, Father God, and we thank you for answering right now in the name of Jesus. Father God, we ask you have your way in this place. Have your way in this service, oh God, as we are hearing the preached word on today. Lord God, let your word move, oh God. Let it resonate in our souls on today, oh God. Lord, that we may be able to apply your word and then go share your word, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Have your divine way, oh God. Go out, Lord God, and heal, deliver, and set free, oh God. Lord God, look upon those that are sick, Lord God. Look upon those that are shut in, oh God. Look upon those that are grieving, Father God. We thank you for the restoration of joy. We thank you, Lord God, for lifting the hung down heads on this morning. Lord God, we thank you for touching, oh God, in the name of Jesus. We thank you for your miracles, Lord God. We thank you for your manifold blessings, Lord God. Have your way, oh God, in the lives of your people on today. For it's by your grace, oh God, that we worship you. It's by your grace, oh God, that we are here. It's by your grace, oh God, that we live and move and have our very being. And we just want to say thank you. We give your name all the glory and honor on today, oh God. Look upon our pastor, Lord God. Anoint him afresh, Lord God. Anoint him afresh, oh God. Let his word go forth, oh God, in your word. With power and authority, Lord God. That when the devil hears the word, oh God, he shakes and flees, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Have your way, oh God, by your grace. We're expecting you to do those things that only you can do. And we give your name all the glory, the honor, the praise in your precious son Jesus' name. Amen, amen, and amen.
His amazing grace.
God's grace.
So I made it.
I made it this far. By the grace of God.
It was God's grace.
God's grace.
It was God's grace. It was God's grace. Not ours. But it was God's amazing grace. When he looked at us, when he thought about us, he administered grace. Thank you, Lord, for your grace. Thank you, God, for your mercy. We didn't deserve it. But, oh, God, thank you for the grace. that unmerited favor. At this time, we're going to go in the Word of God.
All right.
We'll be coming from Acts chapter 9. Okay.
All right.
Now, y'all got to always remember that the worship service is subject to change by move of the Holy Spirit. This is not a show. This is not done in a perfunctory manner.
All right.
But everything moves by the grace of our God.
Yes.
So, Evangelist, if you would allow me.
Yes, sir.
To take us over to Jeremiah chapter 18.
Okay.
Verses 1 through 6.
Right.
And reading from the New Revised Standard Version. The Lord has a way of kind of shaking some things up, doesn't he? Jeremiah chapter 18, beginning at the first verse. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord in reading from the New Revised Standard Version. Come, go down to the potter's house, and there I will let you hear my words. So I went down to the potter's house, and there he was working at his wheel. The vessel he was making of clay was spoiled in the potter's hand. And he reworked it into another vessel as seemed good to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me. Can I not do with you, O house of Israel, just as this potter has done, says the Lord? Just like the clay on the potter's hand, so are you in my hand. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God. Let us rise. Savior saith, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
A lot of hard times down throughout the years.
over my life and the things you brought me through. I can't help but throw my hands up and tell you thank you.
Thank you.
Say amen. For his grace and his mercy that is still sufficient even right now. Hallelujah. My beloved, the text has already been read from Jeremiah chapter 18. And we want you to consider for a subject or a thought. Grace bent. Grace bent. Can I say it one more time to make sure that you hear it in the back corner? Grace bent. My beloved, as you look at the text this morning, many of us are familiar with the story of the potter's house. This is a narrative that is shared by Jeremiah, one of the Old Testament prophets. He's one of the major prophets, and he's considered to be major not because his word is any different than the minors, but because of the length of the text. Major prophet by the name of Jeremiah. One who is called the weeping prophet, because when he looked over Jerusalem and saw its potential, but then looked through real eyes and saw what it had become, he wept, knowing that they could have been in a different place with a different predicament if only they had followed the will of God. Jeremiah was a man who, even in his grief and over his bereavement of his beloved city, Jerusalem, he began to question the justice of God. If we were in the halls of a seminary, we would refer to the justice of God as a theodicy question, where Jeremiah himself is wondering, God, are you just? Because I know that we have been bad, but had we been so terrible that you're going to raise up somebody worse than us in order to punish us. A theodicy question. Jeremiah raised this question because he wondered if God still loved them, looking at how God allowed, if not orchestrated, their destruction. Jeremiah had a few questions to ask of God. And out of his questioning, God sent him down to the potter's house. The Bible tells us that when Jeremiah went down to the potter's house, he peeped through the window. And as he looked through the window, he could see that the potter had some clay in his hands. He put the clay on the wheel and began to spin the wheel, but the clay would not conform to the potter's hands. And so, according to the text, when he saw that the clay would not conform, that it was spoiled, it was warped, then the potter simply crumpled it and started all over. And the Lord sent the word to Jeremiah by looking at the work of the potter, working his wheel, working the clay. Can I not do the same with Israel? If I decide as the potter that I would take Israel and crumple it and to rebuild it, isn't that my prerogative? When I can do what I want to do? Because I am God and the clay cannot talk back to the potter. What audacity does the clay have to ask a question of the potter? Because I can do what I want to the clay. If it means breaking you down, I will break you down. If it means building you back up, I will build you back up. But no matter what happens to the clay, you are in my hands. And when the potter gets done with the clay, one can easily say that the clay has been grace bent. When you are bent by grace, you are not the same as you were when you first entered onto the potter's wheel. When the potter's hand is on you, the potter will leave his fingerprint in you. You won't look the same when the potter gets done. And every now and then, there has to be some struggle that you go through while you're on the potter's wheel, so that the potter can remake you to what he needs you to be. Not everything that we go through is because the enemy sent it our way. Some things we go through, the Lord that we serve allows it to happen. And the text shows us some things God is directly behind. Because it is up to the potter as to what happens to the clay. But at the end of the journey, it is to make us the way in which God desires for his clay to be formed. And as I look at the text, it reminds me of a story from the nursery rhymes. Y'all remember the story of Humpty Dumpty? Humpty Dumpty sat on a wall. Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. All the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty together again. Now, if I could use my sophisticated mind, and if I could go over to the world of nursery rhymes, I could imagine that Humpty Dumpty had gone to an Ivy League school and earned his master's in business. I could imagine that Humpty Dumpty, that brown egg, had gone to an Ivy League because folk told him you don't go to a historically brown egg school if you want the top job. He filled out his application. His guidance counselors told him he shouldn't even apply. How are they going to admit a brown egg into an Ivy League school? You're not a white egg with privilege. You're a brown egg from the other side of the street. You need to go to an HBECU school, a historically brown egg school, because an Ivy League won't take you because you don't deserve to be in the hollow halls of an Ivy League school. Humpty Dumpty didn't care what the guidance counselor said, because Humpty Dumpty said there is something called affirmative action. That only thing it does, it just cracks open the door a little bit for me. But once I get on the other side of the door, then it's up to me. But because of the biases in our society, because of the biases of the Ivy League school that will only look at white eggs of privilege, I need affirmative action to open the door so I can make it in. I looked at Humpty Dumpty's transcript. He did well at the Ivy League school. Matter of fact, Humpty Dumpty graduated at the top of his class in this Ivy League school and gave the commencement address. Some years later, Humpty Dumpty was now the president of a Fortune 500 company. And every day, he would leave from his mansion and drive down the street in his Porsche. He would wave at the three little pigs. He would say good morning to little Bo Peep. He went on down to the baker's house where the baker was making bread. He had his bagel and his cream cheese and his hot tea. Then he went on to his office. But every day when he left the office, Humpty Dumpty went to the wall around the land of make-believe. He would put his hands on the bricks that somebody else had laid before him. And when he would get to the top of the wall, Humpty Dumpty never looked down. He only looked over to see what other company he could have in the land of make-believe. My, 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 my. Some could say that Humpty Dumpty was full of himself. Humpty Dumpty had forgotten about the fact that he was a brown egg, but somebody else had to lay the brick in order for him to climb the wall of success in the first place. But there Humpty Dumpty was, as every day happened, where he's looking out over the land of make-believe, looking up to the clouds and looking out in the city, but never bowing his head. Can I park it there? But one of these days, Humpty Dumpty didn't see another brown egg that was on the wall. The other brown egg reached over and said, "Hey, how you doing there, Humpty? My name is Clarence." Humpty got confused because Clarence the brown egg didn't act like a brown egg. Humpty got confused because Clarence was standing there in a black robe as a brown egg who forgot that he was a brown egg. Humpty didn't pay it any mind because he was focused on what other company that he would acquire. But to his surprise, the text says that Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. It didn't tell you how he fell. But if I could borrow something from Dr. Ann Lightner Fuller, who said Humpty Dumpty got pushed. Who pushed Humpty Dumpty in the first place? Who shoved him off the wall in the first place? My beloved, when I look at the clearance that was the brown egg in the black robe, he pushed Humpty Dumpty. Why did he push Humpty Dumpty? Because Humpty Dumpty had climbed the same ladder that he had climbed. Clarence got tired of somebody else looking like him getting to the same place that he had gotten, and he pushed Humpty Dumpty off the wall. And Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. But then Clarence went back behind the wall and began to remove the bricks. He removed the bricks because he didn't want another brown egg to make it up the same wall that he had climbed in order to get to where he was. What kind of brown egg is this that would dismantle the same system that got him to where he is? What kind of madness is this where he's going to destroy that for somebody else so somebody else can get to where he was? Clarence smirked as he looked down from the wall and said, Humpty, how you like me now? I'm the only brown egg up here. How you like me now? Humpty, looking up in his cracked state, he was shattered. His career was over. He was broken. And we learned from the nursery rhyme that all the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty together again. The firefighters couldn't do it. Martin Barrow couldn't do it. The EMTs couldn't do it. The best surgeon in Greensboro couldn't do it. Nobody could put Humpty Dumpty back together again. While Humpty laid on the ground, he began to look up to heaven. Said, my God, my help in ages past, my hope for years to come, my God whom I have my well-being, in whom I give my trust, my God, I look up to thee. Only my God knows how I made it. My God made me the way that I am. And if my God made me, then my God can recreate me. And he realized as he lay on his back and his yoke spilled on the sidewalk that the only one who could put him back together was the potter who made him in the first place. And out of his humility, Humpty Dumpty began to cry out to God. And the God that he served reached down from heaven and took Humpty Dumpty and put him back together again. He reassembled Humpty Dumpty. And when Humpty Dumpty looked at himself, Humpty Dumpty realized, I'm not the same egg I used to be. Because I have fallen off the wall. And because I've fallen off the wall, the creator, the potter, has remade me. But the way he remade me, I'm not the same Humpty Dumpty that climbed the wall in the first place. The way he remade me, there's a bend that I have. The way he made me, I don't have the same walk. I don't have the same talk because I've fallen too far. I've been picked up from so low. I cannot be the same as I was when I climbed the wall. But because my creator made me, here I am. I stand as a living testimony that no matter what I go through, the potter can remake me. Humpty looked at himself. He didn't look the same. He now had a crack in his shell. He now had a hook in his hand. Instead of his head pointing upwards, he now had a bend in his neck. And no matter how he looked deformed to everybody around him. There are folks said, that's not the same man who used to climb the wall and look out over the city. Humpty said, I may not be the same as I was, but I still know how to climb. Oh, Humpty Dumpty began to climb the wall. He began to rebuild the brick that Clarence had taken off the wall. But this time, when he made it to the top of the wall, he looked out onto the city, and he could no longer look up here. He could no longer look out to what he wanted to conquer, but he could only look down below. You might be saying, preacher, what did he see? When he looked down below, this is the first time he looked at from where he had come from. You got to understand that what had happened to Humpty Dumpty, he was bent by grace. And when you are bent by grace, you're going to look down every now and then to see where you have been and know that the Lord is the one who made a way out of no way. Humpty Dumpty had lost his perspective. He thought he had made it to the top of the wall all by himself. But every now and then, the Lord's got to send something our way to remind us that the Lord is the one who always is there. The Lord is the one who rose us up. The Lord is the one that made the difference. The Lord is the one who opened doors we could not see. We got to remember, don't wait until you're broken, but you got to remember that God made the way. I'm not done. Because Humpty Dumpty, when he looked out over and took inventory of his life, he realized that he did not get to where he was all by himself. But the potter was there every step of the way. The potter is the one who made the door to swing open even before he made application. He had to realize that it is the Lord who broke him, but it is the Lord who remade him. And I want to check this morning to see if there are some Humpty Dumpties who are in this house. You know that it's the Lord that made a way for you. You know that it's the Lord who kept you. It is the Lord who brought you from a mighty long way. It is the Lord that gave you the ladder to climb. It is the Lord that gave you the gift of mind. It is the Lord who gave you your health. It is the Lord who gave you your strength. It is the Lord who made a way out of no way. Are there any Humpty Dumpties in the house? You're going to give God praise. You're going to worship our God. You're going to give him thanks for being God all by himself. And even in spite of struggles and pressures, the potter is still remaking us. In spite of being broken, in spite of being shattered, the Creator is remaking us. And when he gets done, we will be better than we were before. No matter what we're facing, no matter our struggle, God will make us better than we've ever been before. But we will all come out grace-bent. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Grace bent.
Yeah. Yeah.
And when Clarence comes back to try to push you off the wall again, because of the fact that you have a hook in your hand, you're grace bent. He can shove, but he can't remove what the Lord has planted on top of the wall. Because sometimes when you are grace bent, it is that bend that helps you to hold on when you want to let go. You get hooked into the Lord, and because you're hooked in, nothing can ever defeat you. Somebody needs to receive that. Because I don't know what you are going through in your personal lives, in your professional lives, in your economic lives, in your health-wise. I don't know what you are going through. But you got a hook because you're grace bent. And whatever comes against you, you will not fail because the Lord is on your side. Somebody needs to receive that this morning. Because you are going through something right now. Something is trying to take you off the wall right now. But I stop by to let somebody know, because you are grace bent, you cannot be defeated. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God. Hallelujah. Now, my beloved, I will also, in my appeal to you, I will say to you on today, don't wait until things are shattered before you give your life to Christ.
That's right.
Do not wait until you are broken before you give your life to Christ. Give your life to Christ now. And so my personal question to you, have you met Jesus, the co-creator with God the Father, the Logos, made flesh? Have you met Jesus, who has pardoned you of your sins? If you have never confessed Jesus as Lord, my brother, my sister, we offer Christ to you. Will there be one today? Whether you are at home, at work, streaming online, wherever you are, if you want to meet Jesus, today's your day. The next appeal. If you're looking for a church home, we would love to have you here at Bethel. We are a church who believes that we are not a museum for saints, but a hospital for sinners. We're all here because we are Humpty Dumpty. God is in the process of fixing us. And if you're looking for a church home, look no further. We'll be glad to have you. Will there be one today? Please come. First of all, for those who do not know Jesus for the pardoning of your sins, please come. And second of all, those who are looking for a church home, please come. And then the last appeal. If you have a prayer need and a prayer concern, we open this altar to you. There is nothing quite like saints touching and agreeing. Because no matter how hard we run our lives, all of us need prayer at some point in time. It doesn't matter how long we have known Jesus. All of us become weak along the way. And if that describes you, then come on. Or if you have any kind of prayer concern that you wish to us to touch and agree on, you may come. But if no one moves, then we're going to pray for the whole church. Let us pray. Lord, You gave us a word entitled the Grace Pivot, where you are always on turning ground. And now today, God, we heard another word about grace, that we are grace bent. And God, and we thank you for the gift of the bend, for it is the bend that holds us to the wall of opportunity. It is the bend that holds us and the hook in our hands that holds us to you. And we thank you, God, because we know, Lord, that it has not been easy. But you are a God who has taken on all of our burdens, and we thank you. But Lord, we acknowledge right now that some of us are still facing storms in our lives. Storms that will mimic the storm we had in Greensboro on yesterday. Some of us are facing contrary winds and torrential rains. We do not know where daylight can be found, but God, you know. You know the hairs on our head. And God, you know not only how we're made, but you also know what it takes to remake us. Lord, we pray that as we wait for our change, we will not give up on you or give up on ourselves, but that we will hold on to you, for you are a God who's able to do all things but fail. We uplift our concerns. We uplift our brokenness. We uplift our uncertainties, and we give them all over to you right now. And we count it all done because we believe it all to be done in the precious name of Jesus, who is our Christ. And Lord, we love you. We adore you, and we trust you. In his holy name we do pray and ask it all. Let the redeemed of the Lord of our and Savior say, amen and amen. Amen. Thank you, Dr. Hamden. Because truly God's grace is amazing. Amen. Well, my beloved, as I continue to stand on this morning, I'm not going to interrupt the flow of the Spirit by giving you a bunch of announcements. But I do want to remind everyone that you heard in the phone tree message that Sister Jessie Carter will be laid to rest on tomorrow, but the family will have a private memorial service for her. And we pray that you are understanding in terms of their choices and what they need to do at this time. But I will say to you that at the right time, and that right time being next week, we will have a small tribute for our Sister Jessie here at this church during the morning worship hour. Amen? Amen. 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 As we say to our dear sister, our dearly departed sister, servant, well done in all that she has done for this church and for the kingdom of God. And I also want to share with you on today that you will hear in the voicemail that will come out that the church will be closed this week. The church will be closed this week as we have some sickness within the staff. And not only do we have some sickness within the staff, but also I have to be away at the summer summit in Virginia. I will leave today right after service. So the office will be closed. So if you call, you'll just go to the voicemail. But you can still drop by and place things inside of the mail slot if you should desire. Amen? Amen? Amen. And we ask that everything else, you just govern yourselves accordingly to what is in the bulletin. Praise the Lord. We will ask now if our ushers would prepare us. We prepare our tithe and our offering. What a blessing it is to give. Somebody should say amen. What a blessing it is to give. And giving is a part of our worship. And some of us are using the envelope system, and others are using the electronic devices. And as the table comes out from the side of the church, and we call you to stand and come and present your tithe and your offering, we ask that those who are using your electronic devices, that you also come by and touch the basket with your electronic device. Is that all right, everybody? Amen. I don't see the door opening to the side. Amen. I can keep on talking until things are in order. Amen. Thank you, Sister Loretta and Brother Eddie Brelsford. Amen. Dr. Hamden, mind if you give us a little traveling music? Amen. So good that when we gather, that we take a moment to greet one another in Jesus' joy. So I want you to turn to your neighbor and say, good to see you, cuz. Amen. And turn to the other side and say, cuz, good to see you too. Amen. Amen. And make sure that before you leave the sanctuary, that you touch somebody and say, I'm glad to see you on today. Somebody you haven't had a chance to speak to, make sure you speak to them today. Amen? Amen. Because that hug, that handshake may be the only one they receive this week. And you have no idea what that will mean to that person. Amen? Amen. So never be in a hurry where you cannot be hospitable towards one another. And a friend shows himself or herself friendly. Amen? And we are definitely the friendly church on the friendly corner. Amen. So we're going to show how friendly we can be once the benediction is given. Amen. Amen. Come on, Humpty Dumpties. Let's all stand. Amen. Amen. No Clarences in the house. Just Humpties. Amen. Now I want you to repeat after me. I know that I can make it.
I know that I can make it.
I know that I can stand.
No matter what may come my way,
my life is in his hands. Say, neighbor, I know that you can make it. I know that you can stand. No matter what may come your way, your life is in his hands. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Of our Lord and Savior, Jesus, who is the Christ, and the love of God, and the sweet communion and fellowship of his Holy Spirit, may it rest, rule, and abide with each and every one of us, henceforth, now, and forevermore.
So easy for me to explain. It was God's grace.
God's grace.
It was God's grace.
God's grace.
It was God's grace.
God's grace.
His amazing grace.
God's grace.
I made it this far.
I made it this far.
By the grace of God. It was God's grace. It was God's grace.
God's grace.
It was God's grace.
God's grace.
His amazing grace.
God's grace.
Said I made it this far.
I made it this far.
By the grace of God. It was God's grace.
God's grace.
It was God's grace.
God's grace.
It was God's grace. It was God's grace.
God's grace.
I made it this far.
I made it this far.
By the grace of God. It was God's grace.
God's grace.
It was God's grace.
God's grace.
It was God's grace.
God's grace.
His amazing grace.
God's grace.
Said I made it this far.
I made it this far.
By the grace of God. It was God's grace.